Hi everybody and welcome to today's video episode of Bernardo's Tech Blog. Today I'm going to demonstrate how you can build a perfect server for running Proxmox Virtualization Environment, otherwise known as Proxmox VE. Just in case you don't already know what that is, Proxmox is basically a hypervisor. It's built on Debian Linux and it includes two different virtualization technologies, namely KVM and OpenVZ. And then it puts on a fantastic web-based administration interface, and so you can use this system to host virtual servers or virtual machines. Now the title of this video is a little bit misleading. There's really no such thing as a universally perfect server. Everybody's needs are a little different. And so with that in mind, I just want to give you what my objectives were in building this server. First of all, the hardware needs to be compatible with the latest version of Proxmox VE, and that happens to be version 3.0 currently, and I want to be able to just install it and not have to mess with any extra drivers. The server also has to be of sufficient speed and power to host 3 or 4 Linux guests, and possibly more in the future. The server needs to be rack mount, and it also needs to be short depth because I want to be able to mount it in a 2-post rack as opposed to a 4-post rack that would be required if the server is rather deep. The motherboard of this server also needs to have a remote management console so I can shut down and make BIOS configuration changes and restart and so forth from remote. And lastly, I wanted the server to use standard off-the-shelf components as opposed to proprietary stuff that you have trouble finding in the event you need a part. If you'd like to have a complete parts list for this server, head on over to my blog. I'm going to put a link in the description of this video that will get you there, and I'll have the model numbers of everything that I used in that blog post. And for the purposes of this video, I'll just give you the general description of the parts I used. I started out with a Norco case. This is a 2U case. It's about 16 inches deep and it's obviously rack mount. And I've used this one before and I'm pretty pleased with it. I've also done a separate review of this case in another video if you're interested. The first thing I added to the case then is a drive cage from iStar USA. This is a very tight fit. You almost have to stand on this cage to get it in. In fact, you might have to do that. But once it's in there, it works very well. Basically, it takes 2 5.25-inch drive bays and gives you 3 hot swap 3.5-inch bays. As far as power supplies go, when you buy a power supply for this case, you have to be sure that it has fans on the front and or on the back as opposed to the top or the bottom. A lot of the higher wattage power supplies nowadays have big fans at the top or the bottom, and if you use those, it will be blocked by the edges of the case, so make sure you get one that has fans on the front and back. For a processor, I'm using an AMD Opteron 6-core processor. This motherboard will also take an 8-core, although if you get a model that has a really early firmware version, you may have to update the firmware before it will support such a processor. I put in 2 8-gigabyte RAM chips for a total of 16-gigabyte. This motherboard will take at least 32-gigabyte. I'm not sure if it will go any higher than that or not, but for my purposes right now, 16 is going to be fine. Now for a heat sink, the first thing I tried was a Supermicro fanless heat sink that you see here, and I thought maybe there was enough airflow that I could get by with using this, but that didn't turn out too well. It did actually start up and run without overheating, but even with a very small load on it, it was running very hot, and I didn't want to continue that way. So I swapped it out with a Dynatron heatsink and fan. They sell a number of them that are designed for 2U server cases, and they have the side-to-side airflow as opposed to top-to-bottom. This case is pretty tight. You won't get a full-size ATX into it, only a micro ATX or mini ITX. And it's helpful to take out the internal drive bays at least long enough to get the motherboard mounted. I used a Supermicro motherboard with IP management console. And I also put in a RAID card so I can run 2 drives at the same time and have all the data mirrored between them. And lastly, we put on the top cover, and here's the finished product. Now this server is currently running 3 Linux servers as guests, and it really doesn't tax the hardware much at all. I think I could probably put 10 servers on here if I wanted to, as long as the 16 gigabyte of RAM held out. If you have any questions, feel free to put them in the comments. Again, there's a link in the description that will get you over to my blog post that will have more details. As always, thanks for watching, and I'll see you next time.